Hello, everyone, and thanks for joining us for the 11th episode of Hello Nintendo. Today, we're going to be talking a little bit about the Nintendo Switch 3.0 update. We're going to touch on the Pokémon GO updates as well as discuss the new Super Nintendo Classic Mini Edition, whatever Nintendo's calling it now. And we also have with us a couple of the mods that actually went to E3. So we're going to be talking to them, find out what they saw, experienced, liked, and disliked, and who they may have actually encountered. I'm your host for this episode, Matt, a.k.a. TrainAss, and with me again is the bro with the best fro. It's Frobro. How's it going, man?
Oh, it's good as always. Glad to be here.
And we also have with us joining, again today is Michael, a.k.a. iwatafan.
Hey, guys. Good to be here.
And we've got a brand new voice on the podcast. He's never been with us before. You may have heard him around the subreddit a little bit. It is James, a.k.a. the rockincellist.
Hello.
So it's actually been a little while since we've had a new person on the podcast. So it's been a while since we've actually done the whole Q&A thing. James, are you ready to be pestered with some questions?
As long as they don't involve quantum physics, I'm good for anything.
We're not that kind of we're not that kind of podcast. So James, what is it that you actually do for the subreddit?
I'm basically just a general comment moderator. I don't do any of the really cool things like Game Club or running any of the question threads, but I just sort of monitor the comments and step in when things get out of hand or help out with moderating new and watching the queue and things like that. So just a general moderator.
Seems we've got a few pretty much just Reddit cops on the team, eh?
Yep, pretty much.
What was your first game console?
My first game console is the Game Boy Color. I got that for my 5th birthday, I think. 5th or 6th.
Nice, so you started in the handheld generation.
I did. I didn't actually get a console until the N64. That was actually a gift from my uncle, but my first was the Game Boy Color and a copy of Super Mario Bros. Deluxe, which the furthest I got when I was little was like World 4 or something. I never got to the end.
Well, at least your first actual home console was the N64, which was a pretty good start to your home console adventure.
Yeah, I got a copy of Super Smash Bros. And Super Mario 64, so I had a pretty solid start.
Very nice. Did you ever play GoldenEye or Perfect Dark?
I didn't. I was too young for those, so my parents didn't really.
Oh, you missed out, man. You really missed out. Well, you've got Xbox, because you and I, we've played Halo together a few times, so you should definitely grab either Rare Replay or even just grab Perfect Dark as one of the arcade titles, as it's a really good remake of the game, or remaster I should say, kind of a remaster, but definitely need to do it to yourself, check out Perfect Dark.
Alright, thanks for the recommendation, I'll check it out.
So what is up with that username? How did you come up with that? Are you actually a musician or are you a poser?
Well, in middle school and high school, I did play a lot of cello, especially in my school orchestras. And outside of cello, I play electric bass and a little bit of piano and a little bit of guitar. So, yeah, overall, I'm a bit of a musician. And then,
hold on, wait a minute. You just said you play a bass?
Yeah, both upright, double bass, and electric.
I'm telling you, me, you, Embassy, and TrainAss can make a band right now.
That's a great idea.
TrainAss, what you thinking?
I guess I could just beatbox, because I can't.
You said you had a guitar.
Worth anything, so.
I've seen your guitar.
I can't play. Yeah, I'm just learning how to play. I can't play anything.
Bro, fake it till you make
That's
it.
That's true.
We'll just air guitar it?
No, you gotta pretend you're good, and then eventually you'll figure it out. It can't be too hard, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, looks like you've got your newest member at Hot Local Singles.
We still haven't actually put together. We said we would do something, and we actually still haven't.
Maybe this summer. Well, now that all you kids are out of school.
How old do you think I am?
What, you're like 18, aren't you?
No. I'm about to be 23.
Well, sounds like a perfect rNintendo music collaboration.
I think so, yes. So, James, when you're not moderating the subreddit... now, you kind of touched on being a musician, but is there anything else that you do in your free time?
My free time, huh? Well, I just graduated from university with a degree in chemical engineering, so I'm just kind of looking for a job right now.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Aside from that, I also kind of study Japanese on my own, and I minored in it in university as well. So I'm aiming for some of the proficiency exams in the future. So that's about it.
You could probably practice your Japanese by talking to Reese. I think he's kind of fluent in Japanese.
Oh, I didn't know that.
So that would be pretty good. Well, very cool. What games have you been playing in the past week?
Past week, I've been playing a lot of Paper Mario Color Splash, which I just got around to playing, and I really like it for its writing and its music overall, both, and then the visuals. Everything makes it just look and sound really good, and the combat's not as bad as I was expecting. So, overall, I was just kind of surprised how good this game was.
Nice. I might pick it up this summer. It kind of looks like a game my kids would like to watch or at least try to play. So.
I would think so, and especially if you play it with your kids or you watch your kids play it, it's got a lot of dialogue, like not unlike, let's say, a Pixar or a DreamWorks movie, where some of it they won't understand, but some of it you will, because it's a lot of like social commentary on different political or social issues of today, and it would go over their heads, but you would catch it, and if you're like me, you would chuckle a little bit at them poking fun at some of these little political issues.
Well, it might even help my 5-year-old learn how to read. She's working on that, so that's always good. So, Fro,
yep.
What have you been playing in the past week?
Man, adulting has hit me so hard this week. I haven't, like, touched a video game in the past month, dog. I said earlier that I was looking for a game to play, and then a lot of things came up, and I really just don't have time to be playing games. So that's a zero from me.
Jeez, and I'm the one with the full-time job, 2 kids, adult responsibilities, and I still make time to play games.
Bruh, it's hard out here. You don't even know.
Okay. Michael, what about you? What have you been playing the past week?
Well, I tried my best to finish Breath of the Wild before E3, and I succeeded. So I'm kind of in the middle of a vacuum right now with not much to do in the gaming world, I suppose. So I started a new Animal Crossing town. So I'm going to be addicted to that for the next few months. And I'm also playing Oceanhorn on the Switch because I tried playing it on the iPhone, but I cannot stand the controls on the iPhone, so I'm really glad that I have buttons now.
It's nothing better than physical buttons when you're playing
Quick
games.
Question for you there, Mikey. Yeah. How did you finish Breath of the Wild? Like, how did you not lose your motivation after losing your save?
Well, you know, I mean, I have a lot of motivation for Zelda games because they're my favorite type of game there is, favorite series, all that stuff. And I don't know, I just took 2 months to do it, so it took forever. And I accidentally deleted my save after 125 hours, so I had every reason to rage quit.
Ouch.
But
oh, that's gotta
yeah,
be painful.
But, I mean, I don't know. I just kept at it, and I spent a lot of time. Maybe we could say maybe 4 hours a day on average. And if you do that for, I don't know, 8 weeks or so, you can finish Breath of the Wild. You can do all the shrines. You can get all the clothing and anything that you would think to consider it 100% complete. The only thing I didn't do is the Korok seeds. I'm at 5-10 total. So, yeah.
Ten.
Jeez. Sometimes it's hard to, like, avoid getting one of those
right,
seeds.
Right, that's true. And, I mean, the thing is I got 5-10 after meticulously exploring everything I could think. And so I'm still missing just under half anyway, so that kind of gives you an idea of just how many there are. You can be really thorough and still miss that many. Yeah, so I mean, I'm looking forward to the download content, and if I ever have the motivation, I'll walk around with the mask trying to find all the rest, but I don't know, it'll be a while before I go back to Breath of the Wild. I'm going to wait a little bit longer.
Yeah. Well, sorry, yeah, the DLC, the first DLC pack drops in a few
days.
Looking forward to that for sure, yeah. That'll be good. So, myself, I actually, this past weekend, I was at a Defenders of the Triforce breakout room with my wife and some friends. So, if you've ever done a breakout room before, or escape room, that's what this was supposed to be. If you've never done it, the whole idea behind it is, it's kind of like you're playing, like, a mystery or an RPG, but, you know, for real. And so, in this one, it was a whole custom story. They did a partnership with Nintendo, and you end up failing at defeating Ganon, and you end up going into, like, going to sleep or into stasis for 7 years, and you get woken up a little too late. You've got about an hour left to defeat Ganon, and so then you're put into teams of six, and you're then given little puzzles that you have to complete, and you have to go to different places. So you go to Zora's Domain, you go to Kokori Forest, you go to Death Mountain, and then there's the Temple of Time and everything. So you have to do different quests, and there are times where, just like in the real games, where you go to one location, but you can't complete a puzzle or something there, because you have to then go back to a previous location and get something, and so that's kind of what they did. Ultimately, we didn't end up saving Hyrule and defeating Ganon, like my group, because the very last part of the very last puzzle was the Triforce of Courage. And what you're supposed to do is come Temple of Time and get the Master Sword. So we failed because we just could not figure out that last puzzle. But other than that, I've been playing a lot of Cave Story Plus on my Switch. I played a fair bit of it on the 3DS. Loving it on the Switch. It's especially the music. That's such a good soundtrack. So that's what I've been doing, and I hope to actually finish it this time. Well, let's get into our news topics. The first topic for us today is the Nintendo Switch 3.0 update. Michael, why don't you kind of tell us a little bit about the Switch 3 update?
Yeah, absolutely. So, among other things, we have six new icons, and they're all Splatoon 2 related. We can use our Pro Controllers wired now, and that's to prepare probably for the Hori Pokken Fight Pad, which will be obviously used with Pokken. So fighting gamers will love that. And you can actually now use HD Rumble to find your missing Joy-Cons, which is really awesome, actually. That's something that I wouldn't have thought of. Evidently, there will be improved Wi-Fi now. That's been a complaint for some users. You can now choose channels to choose which news you get. So you can curate the content that you get exposed to. There's new accessibility options. There's grayscale, and you can invert the color of the screen. And my personal favorite, you can now add friends from your Wii U and 3DS friends lists, which was not a feature available before for some reason, but now you can reconnect with all those folks you played games with years ago effortlessly.
I actually just took advantage of that. I think I added a couple of you guys to my Switch that I didn't have on there before. It works really nicely because you're using all the same Nintendo accounts.
Yeah, excellent. Yeah, hopefully everyone knew to connect their NNID to their Nintendo account to keep all their stuff in one place, and then that way you get to reconnect even after all these years. So hopefully we'll all have jam-packed friends lists to play against.
Yeah. Don't forget other stability improvements.
Right. Oh, yes. Yes. Stability has been an issue for some people I know.
I have never felt so stable while holding my Nintendo Switch since the 3.0 update has dropped.
Would you say it's more stable than the 3DS?
I don't know. I never had any issues with my 3DS. In fact, I've never even had issues with my Switch, so I can't comment on the lack of stability, personally.
No, I say that because stability is like a patch note on every 3DS update.
Oh, yeah, even on the Wii U, it was other stability improvements. There was never any other details. Oh, one time we got folders, and then it was, other stability improvements.
I don't think we'll ever match 3DS stability. I mean, they built Rome with the 3DS as a brick.
That's right.
They did.
Let me just throw this out there, though. Breath of the Wild DLC hard mode is coming out soon, right?
That's with DLC Pack 1.
Let's make a Dark World-themed hard mode. Invert colors, hold your Joy-Cons backwards and upside down, and play it on hard mode.
Well, that's the way to do it.
What is wrong?
But
what?
Why do you have to flip your Joy-Con, with you?
What is wrong with you? Are you a masochist?
Hey, man, people are making all these cool like Breath of the Wild run-throughs where you have to use only classic Zelda items. I'm just saying, let's make a Dark World run.
That's true. First. I think, wasn't there somebody who beat Halo with the Guitar Hero controller as well? And I think there's been somebody that's done something with like a DDR pad. Those are crazy people.
James, you should totally stream for our Twitch channel in your awesome dark mode, man. That would be awesome.
That's right. It's your idea.
That would not be a bad idea.
Excellent.
Think about
it.
I will tune in for that for sure.
I will say that the Pokken fight pad and the controller wired updates are pretty cool, especially I had a little bit of experience in the past playing on Wii U Smash Bros. Competitively, and while I like the Pro Controller, it's very difficult to use it in a tournament setting because it's basically only wireless. There's a little bit of a cheat you can do by taking out the battery and making it so that it depends on a USB wire source, but otherwise it's a totally wireless controller, which makes it hard to use in tournaments. So this controller update sounds really cool. I'm looking forward to seeing how that can be used in Switch tournaments and both fan run tournaments and Nintendo official tournaments. So
I just want some nice wireless third-party controllers, because Hori has made a couple really nice-looking controllers, but they're wired, and I don't want to have a 20-foot cable across my living room just so I can use a wired controller.
Yeah, the wires are totally for the people who are doing the competitive fighting, but for us casuals, I guess, we don't want to be tripping over wires. I mean, come on. It's the 21st century.
It's the update also brings the ability to use a keyboard as well, a USB keyboard to the Switch. I remember reading that. So Switch has it, Xbox doesn't. What's going on there? Come on, Microsoft.
I'm pretty sure the Xbox you can use a keyboard with, right?
There's keyboard and mouse support that's supposed to be coming. Everybody's asking about it. So okay, moving on, we've got our new Pokemon Go update. Fro, do you want to tell us a little bit about the Pokemon Go updates?
Yeah, I was actually playing it earlier today. Well, I suppose I have been playing games when you asked earlier. I have been messing around with this new update, actually. Among bugs, they added a lot of bugs, but they also added some new features. They completely revamped the gym system and the way you get coins from gyms. They've added new raid battles. It's kind of like a gym that with one Pokemon with super high HP, or I mean it's got completely inflated stats across the board, and it's like a colorless gym that no matter what team you're on, you can collaborate and take down, and then you get an opportunity to catch the Pokemon. What else did they add? And then the raids bring in some new items like golden raspberries, rare candies. I mean, it's overall a fun time if you get past the bugs, of which there are plenty. Did I say that? Because there's a lot of bugs, and it's the most annoying thing.
And not just bug Pokemon.
And not just bug Pokemon, no.
Well, that's cool. Like, I haven't touched Pokemon Go pretty much since it dropped, but everybody that I work with, they're all over that. I guess there was a raid this morning, and so there's a group of like 4 or 5 of them all phones out, hunched over, doing some Pokemon raid. And then I guess where my work is, it used to just be a Pokestop, and now it's a gym.
Now it's a gym, yeah. A lot of Pokestops got changed into gyms, and then they changed the way gyms are, so like now all gyms are also Pokestops. I really wish that this is the game that launched last year, because this is much better. This is much closer to the trailer, the original vision they had for the game. But, you know, for whatever reason, that game got rushed out when it really needed another year in the oven. Oh, well.
Oh, well, still seems that there's lots of people playing it, and it's doing well, so that's always good. It's helping the Nintendo stock go up, and I'm happy about that, because I got Nintendo stock.
How much?
I've got 3 shares.
What do you care about the stocks then?
I'm at like $145 US though, so
you'll never cash it in though.
I will never cash it in. Doesn't matter. The fact that I own 3 bits of Nintendo is all makes me happy. So Nintendo has also officially announced, much to nobody's surprise, a Super Nintendo Classic Mini.
Hold up, you said to no one's surprise. That's not true. I'm completely surprised. I thought they were going to wait to an anniversary year to do it. Especially after the NES Classic left such a bad taste in some people's mouths. I mean,
I guess, yeah. But I mean, there's
I was
also...
definitely surprised by the timing.
Were you?
You're not?
Yeah.
I don't know how. I mean, I'm not one of those people who are upset. I saw, because I run the Talk It Out Tuesday thread. Someone posted that Nintendo putting out the Super NES is anti-consumer. That's the word he chose.
Anti-consumer.
And it was one of the long ones. If you go, you can go read his comment. I'm not going to put the man on blast, but he called it anti-consumer. He's legitimately upset at this.
I don't know. There was somebody on another group that I'm a part of, and they kind of calculated out how much each of the games cost. And it works out to, if you were to buy each of these games on the Virtual Console at their current price, and I think it was going based on the Wii U, the price for the Wii U, it worked out to something like $160.
Yeah, that's right.
And you're getting everything for 80 US or $100 Canadian. So
don't forget the 2 controllers, though.
That's a really good deal.
Does SNES Classic controllers, do they still have that little Wiimote input thing?
Yep.
Yes. Yeah.
Can I?
When I first saw the picture, it looked like they were going to actually use Super Nintendo controllers. I thought that would have been really cool. But no, that actually flips down, and there's two Wii
extensions, whatever it's called. I really feel that this is a missed opportunity. If they just made it a USB controller, then you could have used it on the Switch VC when it comes around.
I guess you could have, but they're going for the whole wired thing, the whole retro, you know, nostalgia, that whole thing.
Yeah, but now it's only good on legacy tech. They really could have, it could have been used on the Switch if it was just a USB.
That's true.
I guess the argument is that the Wii Classic controllers are then compatible with the SNES Classic.
Is that what they're going
for?
Which
are kind of SNES shaped.
How many people
anyway?
Even have that thing? I mean, I do. I've got two.
I have one. I have two, actually.
I have.
But it already comes with two SNES controllers. Why do I need to use my Wii Classic?
Well,
that's a good point.
See, I'm curious. The Classic controller, the home button sends you right back to the main menu. Now, I'm going based on the NES Classic, but using a Wii Classic controller, the Pro Classic controller, you hit the home button, it takes you right back to the main menu. You've got your analog sticks for, because there's some people that prefer the analog sticks over D-pad. And personally, for me, it depends on the game. And then, it's a little bit more comfortable grip, so I could see same thing happening on the Super NES Classic.
We can't keep going on like this, tiptoeing around it. Star Fox 2's on this thing, though.
Yes.
Finally, officially released.
I don't know about this, guys, because, this is not... I mean, not that Nintendo... It's not that Nintendo plans these shortages, but, Nintendo... It's either they over-manufacture or there will be shortages, because scalpers love Nintendo products.
Oh, there's going to be shortages. There's no question about it. In fact,
this is the only way to play Star Fox 2, though.
Legally.
And legally. And that's another thing. You guys, firsthand, Matt, how the NES Classic got ate up by piracy fast. Is the SNES Classic going to get opened up just as, all the same? And what's the protection on the Star Fox 2 ROM? Will it be playable, within a day of it being on retail?
Yeah, you know what? If the NES Classic is anything to go by, I think the Super NES Classic may end up actually being hacked faster, because people have already... They're going to at least try and use what they've done and learned and discovered with the NES Classic on the Super NES Classic. This is going to get hacked. And honestly, I think it's going to be hacked faster than the NES was.
Do you think Nintendo would make that same mistake twice? You see how they're tiptoeing with the Switch because they saw how the 3DS and Wii U got completely wrecked? You see what they're doing with the Switch? You think maybe they'll take that same mentality and like completely...
No console is impenetrable forever.
Yeah, but Nintendo's like really... The Switch doesn't have what some people would consider like mandatory features.
Yeah, it's missing
the
browser.
And I'm pretty sure that's because they don't want to go... Like, they don't... I think that's because that's the... That was the exploit on the Wii U. Or at least one of them was connected to the browser.
Yeah, on the Wii U, there was a browser exploit on the Wii. The initial one was Twilight Princess. You caused a buffer overflow, and then you could sideload. And then eventually, there was a few others. There was, I think, something with Smash, and then Lego Batman as well. Same thing. And, even on the Wii U... Oh no, yeah, that gets you to do. That gets you to be able to load Wii U titles as well, but I don't think the Xbox One has been compromised yet.
Is anyone trying? I mean, is anyone really trying?
Oh, everyone's always trying.
I'm not sure.
You can count on that.
I know the PS4 has. Yeah. No, but yeah, I think it's just a matter of time. Like I said earlier, I think the NES Super NES Classic is going to get hacked sooner. It's going to be interesting to see what Nintendo has done, however, to either try and prevent it for as long as possible, or if they've made any changes to the Super NES Classic from the NES to prevent adding additional titles, whether it's, you know, putting even less storage on there, things like that. Really, that's the only thing that I can think of, because if this is running Linux like the NES Classic was, it's going to be cracked open pretty quickly. Then the only thing that they can do is put even less storage on there. Enough storage just to fit those titles and their save states, and then that's it. Like, that's honestly, personally, I think that's the only way that I think they could prevent.
Hold on, am I reading that right? Is that Yoshi's Island?
That's Yoshi's Island, dude.
Wait, like the Super FX
Yoshi's
Island?
Yes, they have a Super FX chip in it. That's how Star Fox 2 is on there, man.
But I thought those games were stuck in some kind of legal limbo because Argonaut doesn't exist anymore.
Not anymore. Nintendo negotiated it, evidently. We don't know how.
With who?
But we do know there's a Super FX chip in this, so that's awesome.
Do you think if we ask Steve, he could help us? Doesn't Steve listen to the podcast? Steve, can you tell us? Just shoot us a mod mail.
Yeah.
Let's hope we get a mod mail.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. We need to get an interview with him.
Oh, and one more thing. That Street Fighter 2 we have is different from the one on the Super Famicom version. Anyone know what the difference between those two are?
Street Fighter 2 Hyper Fighting?
Yeah, and they got the new challenges. Wait, is that the one that's got Cammy on it? I don't know. I don't know enough about Street Fighter 2 specifically to know if we got boned on that one or not. Well, we got Earthbound and Super Punch out, so ours is better. Easy.
And Super Mario World and F-Zero.
Wait, no, but there's...
And Donkey Kong Country.
No, I'm saying ours has Earthbound and theirs doesn't. And ours has Super Punch Out and theirs doesn't.
Honestly, I think this selection of games on the Super NES Classic is hands down better than the selection that came out on the NES Classic.
That's because NES games are garbage, though. We've been through this.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Moving on. But yeah, no, I think there's a lot more games on here that people are the NES Classic had a lot of really good, you know, had a lot of good games on it, but there were some odd omissions, you know, from that one. But I think they may have learned, or there's just the Super NES may have just had, I think it, yeah, it just had better games. So
are there any omissions to this list that stand out immediately? I mean, I can't think of anything.
Chrono Trigger gets named a lot.
Chrono Trigger.
Yes.
That's right.
But that's going to be, they're going to have, well, I guess they're included Final Fantasy 3, so.
Well, that's not, that's Final Fantasy 6. Let's clarify, that's Final Fantasy 6, and that's the best
okay,
one.
Okay, so it's got a Final Fantasy game. So, I mean, they've got to have something good with Square, but.
But they got Legend of the Seven Stars, though. They got Mario RPG. Like, I don't see what was stopping Chrono Trigger other
true.
Than Square
saying no. Yeah, they've got two Square games on there. So, yeah,
Has Legend of the Seven Stars ever been released on
I'm pretty sure
the 3DS the Wii. Or the Wii
I'm pretty sure it's
SNES?
On both the Wii and the Wii U.
Yep.
I think it's on both.
It is.
The Wii that's and
right.
the Wii U?
Yeah, that's right. And, you know, the only omissions, and this is a random request anyways, but I would want at some point to actually experience those satellite-view versions of all those NES games they remade with the different textures. And I think there was even Zelda title as well.
I bet we'll see that in the Virtual Boy Classic any day now.
You think there's going to be a Virtual Boy Classic?
Wait. There's like two good Virtual Boy games I hear. That's more than the NES Classic had. They'll do it.
I think there's... What are Super Mario
there's
and...
There's a Wario
no,
Land.
You're,
yeah, and Tennis.
What's it called? Super Jack Bros? No, the Atlas game on Virtual Boy. Hello? That one. You guys don't know the one?
I don't know.
There's an Atlas game on so Virtual Boy, had... and I heard that's the other good one.
I'm pulling up the list of the games right now. Come on,
all
Wikipedia.
14 of them.
Yep.
So there were a total of 24 games. 8 Japan exclusive, 3 US exclusive, or North America. So 3D Tetris, Bomberman Panic, Galactic Pinball, Golf, Jack Bros,
that
Mario
one.
Clash,
Jack Bros. That's the
Mario's
one.
Tennis, Nestor's Funky Bowling, Red Alarm, Telero Boxer, Vertical Force, Virtual Boy Wario Land, Virtual League Baseball, and Water World.
So again, better than the NES Classic, all right, like right there, because it had like 3 games worth talking about.
Yeah, there's oh cool. There was a Mario Kart in development for it.
That would have been Virtual so Cup. Headache. That would have been headache in Disney. I don't who oh, want that.
No, Virtual Boy Star Fox. There's a
Gosh,
Virtual
that
Boy
sounds
Star
even
Fox
worse.
Even developed.
Those sound amazing to me. I mean, forget the red headache causing stuff, man. I mean, the games itself. That sounds compelling. It's regrettable that doesn't come
no,
into
the,
existence.
Have you seen SNES Star Fox? I don't think you understand. I can't look at that for 5 seconds.
I'm an optimist.
It's got nothing to do with red headache. It'll be, gosh, you're a masochist. You know that, right?
Yeah,
you like
well, me and James,
people.
Evidently. We just like torturing ourselves, I guess, so...
Yeah,
there
clearly.
You go.
No, I think the 3DS is... If we were supposed to get any Virtual Console or Virtual Boy games re-released, the 3DS is the perfect platform for it, because you can turn on the 3D, and it's not going to kill
point.
You. You know, so I think, if anything, we should be seeing Virtual Boy games released on the 3DS, not... a mini Virtual Boy.
But do you think about the backlash if Nintendo actually started putting Virtual Console games on the 3DS VC? You know how many people are going to get upset that they're not doing anything for the Switch and they're over here like scraping the bottom of the barrel for the 3DS?
But you got to think about it. It's a 3D title.
You're oh no,
gonna,
I agree.
It's going to be better played on a system that's capable of glasses-free 3D than it's a system that's 2D only.
Oh, I agree with you. It's just people like complaining on the internet. And we run a forum where people really like to do that.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, they do. People love to complain. So moving on, I think we're going to pester our E3 mods, ask them some questions, and get some first-hand experiences from E3. So James and Michael, this was the first time... regular people had ever been able to go to E3. We also got invites directly from Nintendo to go to E3. Kind of on a scale of 1 to 10, what was your excitement level when you guys first arrived at the at the conference centers?
Scale of 1 to 10, I would have to say an 11. I was super excited when I first got there.
Yeah, I would have to say a 12, man, because I know I was more excited than James.
What <Hello. laughs>
So can you kind of tell us a little bit about what it was that Nintendo provided? Because I know there was some talk about like a VIP section. So what did you guys get to see? And kind of what did Nintendo let you guys do while you were there?
Well, what Nintendo did provide was what's called an Expo Pro Pass, which after asking everybody we could, we found out that it's no different to a normal Expo Pass in that, except for the fact that it's usually given away for free by companies. But So what Nintendo did provide was on day two of the experience of the E3 conference, they brought us over to their little VIP area, which is next to the gigantic booth that you saw in the Nintendo Treehouse or the direct footage. And in that area were mostly just media or developer people gathered, and Nintendo showed off some of the games. They had one kiosk for the 30 of us who showed up from Nintendo, Nintendo Switch, and 3DS.
There are 30 of you guys? Any...
They broke us into groups of two.
Overall, 30 of us.
Yeah.
Yeah. So they let us pick a demo, and because there wasn't much time, we basically played half of a demo that you could play on the show floor. So I ended up playing Super Mario Odyssey. They also had a little area where they were showing off the new 2DS XL, which wasn't on the floor. So a few of us, like about six in our group at least, got to break off and hold the 2DS and try out some of the games. I believe it was Mario and Luigi, Superstar Saga, Ever Oasis, and Miitopia. Is that right, Michael?
That's right.
What did you think about the 2DS?
Well, I love the 2DS. I spent most of E3 not really playing a lot of demos, honestly, because there was a lot to see, but this is one demo I wanted to try out because I just wanted to hold the hardware in my hands because, you know, the 2DS XL looks pretty compelling. The new 2DS XL. We have to get used to Nintendo's naming scheme here. And yeah, it was great. It was light and very slick looking. I think it's a very appealing device that people who are looking to upgrade or perhaps buy into the 3DS, 2DS family for the first time, it's certainly a good idea to go for that. I mean, the only downside that I can think of is that it's missing the 3D feature, but, you know, that's certainly auxiliary. That's not something you absolutely need to enjoy gaming on the 3DS family of games. So, yeah, overall, I thought it was a great device, and I'm looking forward to it releasing.
When the new 2DS is closed, is it as nice as it seems? Like, the DS Lite was such a beautiful handheld, and just the way it closed up and sealed and everything, is the new one kind of similar to that? I know it's a weird question.
No, it's true. I actually checked that out because my main thing was I wanted to know how the hinge was because on my new 3DS XL, the hinge can be kind of jagged. It will snap into place at certain angles, and it can be kind of wobbly. And so I wanted to know, is the quality of the hinge improved? And as far as I remember, anyways, it was smooth all the way, so it would hold its place wherever you left it, and it would just smoothly open up and close, kind of like any laptop, is the closest comparison. So I think they did a good job on making it feel luxurious.
That's awesome. That's nice. I think you're really reinforcing my want for the new one. I think it might be time for an upgrade.
Yeah, definitely. I know I'm upgrading.
So what games did you guys get to try out in the Nintendo booth?
In the Nintendo booth, it was really hard to get in line for any sort of games because, especially for Odyssey or ARMS or Pokken, lines would stretch out and around the booths, and they would cap out the lines so that if you try to line up at the end, at most they would let you wait like 3 hours or 2 or 3 hours.
Holy
but
cow.
Bruh.
They never let it get past any further than that.
Still 2-3 hours to wait. My goodness.
To play what? A five-minute demo?
If you stuck it out, you got a cool Mario hat. Oh, sorry, Frobro, you go.
You waited 3 hours to play a 5-minute demo?
Well, that's the other thing. These demos were actually like 30 minutes long. So that's another reason why a lot of these lines were super long. But a lot of these demos were pretty substantial, and you got a good taste of the game. But what I did get to try out in the Nintendo booth was I was just walking through and they opened up the line back up for Mario plus Rabbids. And I just kind of jumped in. I didn't realize at the time it was for that. And I waited only about 45 minutes. Then I got to play the Mario game, the Mario plus Rabbids game. And that game is pleasantly surprising. Like, it looked interesting, but actually being able to play it, I had a lot of fun with it.
Oh.
And definitely compared it to a lot of Fire Emblem, which was the only tactical game that I've ever played.
Before moving on away from that game, I just want to share my quick conspiracy theory. I think that game was intentionally leaked to float the idea of Rabbids being in a Mario game. That way we could go through the cycle of grief, like all the way from denial to acceptance before the game even came out.
Well, doesn't Ubisoft have like some of the worst track records for keeping secret game secrets?
Do you think that's on purpose, though? Perhaps it's calculated.
With everything that was, it was either their security is ridiculously horrible, or it was done on purpose. I mean, both of those are very plausible explanations.
Unfortunately.
It felt very purposeful, and I think Frobro's probably right, because, I mean, it is kind of a foreign concept. You know, we've had Mario and Sonic, and we've probably had a few cameo appearances, but by and large, Mario's kind of been in his own world, and then, of all things, for him to have a full-fledged game, not even with Sonic, because really those have always been side games, Mario and Sonic at the Olympics, but to have it be Rabbids, that's really unexpected. So honestly, I think Frobro might be right that this is something that people needed a lot of time to get used to, because we all know how stubborn gamers can be sometimes. We like what we're used to. And yeah. So,
yeah, exactly.
So
yeah.
Who knows?
So... did you guys end up getting to see any big names? Did you happen to see the Reginator or Miyamoto or, or Bill or anybody like that when you were there?
Well, I mean, we had the chance. The entire moderator teams from rNintendo Switch, r3DS, we all had a meetup with Bill. So Bill came down to see us, and he took a group photo with us and signed a lot of people's Switches, did a lot of selfies. And so that was cool. He was with us for maybe 10 minutes, and then that was downstairs. So we go upstairs to the VIP area in the Nintendo booth, and there are just developers from Yacht Club Games and Way Forward just walking around, and Reggie walked by two or three times just casually with his security guard. He smiled at us, but, you know, there was no engagement. And then in the distance, there was some doors that people were going in and out of, presumably conference rooms or something. And I happened to spot Miyamoto for a quick 2 seconds, just walking in there. So, yeah, we were in this area where people were kind of free from the crowds of E3. And Nintendo executives could walk around freely, and all their friends as well. So that was probably the most exciting aspect of the VIP area, I would say.
That's kind of cool.
But did you ask Bill for an AMA, though?
Yes. Asking the tough questions there. Thanks, bro.
We couldn't do that in front of our subreddit friends.
Yes, you could have.
I mean, we have to do
You guys had one job to do.
Well, you know, we were so starstruck because we were in this conversation with Steve, who is the head of social at NOA. He's the guy who coordinated all our Reddit teams visiting.
And I hear he's the one who listens to us?
Yeah, he said he listens to Hello Nintendo. And
big,
I mean,
shout out, Steve.
I was
Thank
personally...
you.
Yeah, I was really excited about that, and in addition, he and his team, they do read our subreddits, and so they know what's going on. They try to keep a tap on fans and what they're talking about, and they do take those conversations to the relevant areas in the company. So, I mean, not all is lost, basically. They're listening. So I thought that was so interesting, because I didn't expect that.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Steve.
Yeah, absolutely.
Come on our podcast.
Matt, you remember a couple of years ago we were talking about how we didn't even think Nintendo even knew we existed?
Yep, and now we have
confirmation.
Empirical evidence. Yeah.
One of the coolest things that Steve said to us was they are aware of like all the people on subreddits and stuff like that requesting all of the games that we do, like Metroid and Mother 3 and all those games, and they're really enthusiastic. They see it as enthusiasm and a real like desire for us to play their products, and they're happy about it. But at the same time, they really want us to understand that they can't release everything at once. They have to make it first, and then they have to kind of pace it out so that way the Switch has a solid lineup throughout its life cycle.
Did you ask what him I just specifically heard you... about Mother 3, though?
I asked him point blank, what about Mother 3? And They had responses. They had prepared responses for things. Like, they really, we can't really did. Talk about that.
Of course, they'd have responses. But what
he did make a funny joke about laser eyes and disintegration. So,
but what I heard you just say is that we were directly responsible for Metroid Prime 4 because of the amount of complaining and comments about Metroid on the subreddit. So good job, rNintendo.
Good job. Don't forget the Pokémon Core RPG on the Switch, which I think a lot of people, especially in other Nintendo communities on Reddit, they were really, really into the concept of a Core RPG title on the Switch. And so the whole showcase that Nintendo did this year was basically like, guys, don't complain about this anymore. It's coming. Yeah. Please, just stay
but
cool.
But Mother 3
It'll
isn't coming, though, Mikey.
Soon enough.
I can still get mad at Mother 3, though.
That's true. Now. I know. They left Mother 3 and F-Zero hanging.
Well,
F-Zero
deserves
it.
But Mother 3, though?
F-Zero deserved it.
Maybe they're waiting for the anniversary.
F-Zero duty, man.
When did Mother 3 come out? Like, Mother 3 came out like 2003, something like that? Maybe they're going to wait for an anniversary year. Like they did with Earthbound Beginnings.
The Game Boy Advance Classic.
Let's go. Wait, no, please don't do that. Oh my gosh, don't give them ideas. Please stop.
Matt, you gave me an idea, though. It seems like our subreddit was able to bring Metroid Prime 4 and Pokemon RPG into existence through our sheer determination and complaining.
Yep.
I say now we take that effort and determination and focus it on Elite Beat Agents for the Switch.
Stop. No, why would you waste it on that? If we got any sway,
saying, man,
we
haven't
do...
had a game in generations, so I think it's our turn to get some love.
I think so.
It's not that I disagree. It's just that everybody sucks at that game, man. And I mean, I don't know if we have the time to bruise our egos these days. You know, I mean,
you
games
just gotta
are getting
get good.
Easier.
I'm sure they can work in a golden block, feather, whatever mode for Elite Beat Agents.
Yeah, that's what they'll have to do in order for people like me to survive who love video games but pretty much have no skill in them.
So with being there even for day one of E3, when Nintendo had their showcase, did you guys get to go anywhere and see it and watch it, or did they put it up on any TVs or screens so that people could watch it when they're waiting for 3 hours for a game, things like that, or were you kind of screwed and had to go do your own thing?
You know, ironically, being at E3 made it more difficult to follow what was going on Nintendo announcement wise and like things with the Direct or the presentation or even just the overall treehouse. Being at E3 made it difficult for a few reasons. One, there were no giant screens around the area. There was a giant screen in the Nintendo booth, but we couldn't see that for the initial Nintendo presentation because that was inside and they didn't open the show floor until, I don't know, like 10 or 12 p.m. on the first day. The second reason why it was difficult is because there were just so many people and there was so much congestion on the cellular networks that it made it difficult to watch the presentation live via the internet through cell phones. But a few of us waiting in line, a few of us Nintendo subreddit moderators decided we didn't really want to wait in line anymore, so we found a nearby cafe area and sat down, and I loaded up the presentation on my smartphone and like three of us huddled around it just to kind of like see a really, I don't know, 320p resolution feed of this coming in just so we can kind of follow the announcements going on.
That pixel looks like a game.
Wait, but didn't someone uploaded a picture from the E3 show floor. They were like, couldn't you watch the Treehouse Direct like live?
Yeah, we could, but only if we were in the Nintendo booth. But because the Nintendo booth was always so crowded and because there's just so many people there, it made it sometimes hard to hear what was going on, too. So and
you're
of
saying
course, we couldn't be at the...
I was better off not going. Just say that for me, please.
If you wanted to follow every single...
Just say that I was better off not going. I need validation.
I will say that there is an excitement being there and actually seeing like Pokken tournaments in front of you on stage. So there are pros and cons to both.
So, oh man, no, Harrison, I'll make you feel better. E3 was terrible. Don't even try.
Well,
man,
wait. Okay, horrible. Here's the nail in the coffin. Did you get a personal picture just you and Bill?
Not me. A
Wait,
few
what?
People got selfies.
Wait, we're, you're supposed to say
I got
no.
my 3DS signed.
Your 3DS by Bill oh. Trent. Ugh, I should have went.
Poor Fro.
I think Michael got his Switch signed, right?
No. I mean, I had my Switch with me, but I was kind of thinking about it, and I said, you know, I'm going to just rub this out from playing it. And so what I'm going to end up doing if I have this guy sign it is I'm going to put it in some sort of museum-like case and and never touch it again. So, you know, I ended up saying, oh, I'll just have this memory in my heart forever. Now, do I regret that decision? Well, sort of, but too late now, so whatever.
Yeah. So because you guys were watching the showcase on your phone, presumably where other people, when they announced, or sorry, when other people were you know, also in the areas, when they announced that Pokemon for Switch was being developed and Metroid Prime 4 was, you know, was in development, could you hear collective screams and shrieks of excitement from other areas of the conference center?
Oh man, that was such a cool moment, especially with the Metroid Prime 4 thing. Like when the space opened up, we started like sensing there was a reaction going on around us. But as the Metroid Prime logo came into view, people around us were freaking out. And like we can hear screams coming from across the hall and from the tables right next to us. So it was pretty cool being in the middle of a bunch of other people who also saw this announcement at the same time.
That's pretty cool. Be a really interesting experience. So I know you guys were there primarily for Nintendo stuff, but did you end up venturing out, seeing anything else, check out any other games, anything like that?
Yeah, I mean, I checked out every single booth, at least visually. It was hard to interact for long periods of time with any one booth because there's so much to do. I mean, you could spend at least one full day just walking around looking at things, and that's basically what I did. My brother was with me, and he's a big PC gamer, and the PC Master Race folks are going to hate this, but the lines for the PC games were kind of non-existent, so those were some of the demos I played, and in addition to that, there was the E3 Coliseum, Jeff Keighley, who often gets in spats with playful spats with Reggie. Mm-hmm. He hosts all these panels and interviews and discussions for 2 days of the 3-day conference. So I swooped in and did some of that. The highlight ones I went to was there was a Sea of Thieves panel, just three developers of Sea of Thieves, and that was awesome. There was a panel for the people who made the Xbox, all the hardware. They were talking all the nitty-gritty details about that. That was great. And then my personal favorite was Jack Black talking with Tim Schafer, who is the lead director, I think, for Psychonauts.
Did you get to meet Jack Black?
I didn't meet him. I saw him on stage, though. So, I mean, you know, I saw him in real life.
I missed out so hard.
Fro, we're going to go next year.
Okay? I'm not going next year. You hear that 3-hour line? Miss me with that.
So we, you know, we don't get to play all the Nintendo games.
And you don't
There's
get
so
to see
to
the
do.
Direct. And you can't even use data to, like, send nudes to girls or whatever you do in your free time. Nah, dog.
Details.
I'm sorry.
I'm hoping that next year, you know, I'm hoping Nintendo definitely extends us an invite next year. And I'm kind of hoping, personally, I'm hoping Microsoft extends one to, you know, to the Xbox group as well. So I can get the chance to go to actually both. I've started saving my money so I can get my plane ticket and a hotel and everything like that to go out there. Because I think that sounds like it was a lot of fun.
Yeah, speaking of the Xbox, I'm like you said earlier in the podcast, I'm also a huge Xbox One gamer, so I checked out a lot of the Xbox booth and hung around there. They're more aggressive when it comes to line capping, so it was hard to get in line in the first place, especially for Sea of Thieves. But I got to try out Minecraft, the Better Together update, where they had an Xbox One and a PC, Windows 10, playing together. So, I mean, that directly applies to us too, because we on the Nintendo Switch will be part of that update and able to play with the Xbox One and PC in the same way.
Yeah.
So that was pretty cool.
If only it was out and you could have just kind of slid up right next to them and go, hey guys, and played with your Switch while they're playing.
That would have been cool.
That would have been awesome, but
Also cool was, I don't know if anyone of you or anyone listening is a fan of Rooster Teeth, but I ran into Jack Patillo of Achievement Hunter and Bernie Burns of Rooster Teeth, and I got to take a picture with both of them. So that was definitely a highlight of my trip.
That's cool. What's Bernie like in person?
Bernie is pretty cool, and he's really chill, but he's also, I don't want to say this like an offensive way, but he's a lot larger in person, you know, like in a built way. Like he's pretty, like when you, it's different seeing him on camera and just like on the podcast and his voice through Red versus Blue, but seeing him in person was really cool. Definitely a lot taller and a lot more built than I was expecting.
So we kind of talked about some of the cool things you saw, what you guys liked. What were some of the least favorite things, or the things that annoyed you the most about going to E3? I mean, the lines are kind of a given. That would annoy pretty much anybody. But so excluding the ridiculous lines, what were some of the things that you didn't like about E3, or, you know, kind of annoyed you?
Well, you know, I mean, this may not be that great of a complaint, but, you know, E3 is primarily a press conference. And so what that means is the press is really busy while they're there. They're doing interviews and this and that. But if you're there as a consumer, which, you know, we were prosumers, but by and large, that was the same as being a consumer, mm-hmm. as James was saying, all you do are the exhibits. There's the E3 Coliseum if you want to listen to some panels, but you don't necessarily want to sit in a theater all day when you're at E3. So, you know, what I would say is, in addition to the exhibits and in addition to the E3 Coliseum, have something else going on too. I mean, it could be presentations, but somewhere near the exhibits, or some sort of live broadcast where you could be in the audience watching maybe Nintendo Treehouse interview major developers like Aonuma or Miyamoto or whatever. Mm-hmm. Because this year, the Treehouse was literally a treehouse. It was on the second floor, and no one could see it. So, yeah, just something else to do besides look at exhibits. I say that would make it a full-rounded, well-rounded experience.
So kind of treat it more like a convention, you know, like a geeky convention where there's, you know, as opposed to just a big news area.
Yeah, just a little bit more catering to the 10 or 20,000 consumers who went. But other than that, I mean, you know, as always, E3 was a great thing to experience this time right there on the show floor versus just through my computer screen. So, you know, by and large, I'm very grateful for the opportunity that Nintendo gave us all. But yeah, if I had to nitpick, that's what I'd say.
Well, I guess this was also the first year that it was open to the general public, so maybe next year there will be some good changes, you know, kind of how you described.
Oh, I imagine they'll have learned some things from this year and adapt accordingly.
Yeah,
for sure.
What about you? What about you, James?
I will say that kind of going along with the whole first year thing, the game demos are probably primarily intended for people of the media and of the press and other developers to try out. So I will say that game demos for the general public, I felt like they were kind of long. They had this one game, Sega PC game called Warhammer, I think it was called Warhammer, where they had this gigantic room filled with 30 computers, and they were like putting people in and taking people out by batches. So 30 people went in at a time, and because of that, I kind of assumed it was a massive team game, or at least a few team games, but it wasn't. It was a single player demo, which was kind of confusing. But when I played the demo, I got all the way through it, and I was just kind of left there surrounded by all these other people playing and kind of going like, now what? They don't really, people at E3 don't really tell you when to stop playing the demo unless there's a hard cutoff point of the demo. If you're done, I kind of thought, because I waited for this huge batch of 30 to go out and for me to go on, maybe I should just stay here and try out the hard mode or try out the game again and see what it's like. But I feel like they don't do a very good job with managing game demo times. And there were other times when I was like playing and playing other demo games I'd been waiting in line for, and I play it and I got to it and I play a few minutes and I don't want to play anymore the demo, but the handler is like right there next to me and trying to explain the game and like convince me it's the greatest game ever, and I'm like, I don't actually want to play anymore, I'm good, I'm gonna go now. And especially games like I went to the XC booth and they had some really cool games, but some of the demos were really long and they were like almost full single player games, and like I was just waiting behind this one guy who kept playing. So I feel like maybe next time for the general public, I think making game demos a little bit shorter would be a good idea.
I got one more question before we move on. Do you guys feel that E3 is better off staying as a industry only thing with press and other developers?
Yeah, you know what? I would say that, you know, keeping this in mind, I didn't say it too much here, but E3 is not even so much a good place for developers. I mean, they can certainly communicate with each other and socialize behind closed doors, but it's not like a formal business event where they get continuing education and this and that. They go to the Game Developers Conference in March. So really, it is focused on the press. And I would say if they want to incorporate the general public into E3, they might want to think about different facilities. Because the LA Convention Center was kind of stuffed. For instance, you couldn't walk around the Xbox booth without getting extreme claustrophobia, at least every single time I attempted. The Nintendo booth was stuffed completely. And so I would say just from a general ability to move around comfortably, they might want to get even bigger facilities than the LA Convention Center offers. But other than that, I think it's okay to let the general public in. The good news is even if you don't go to E3, since only maybe 20,000 general public people can go, even if they don't go, they can see pretty much everything that matters through the various streams, the various presentations that are offered online. So it's not that you're missing out if you don't get to be there, but yeah, certainly if they're going to start catering to the general public physically being there, we need more space, I think.
Not to mention the smell.
Yeah. Yes. We all know what that's about.
Wait. I've been to enough LAN parties that I can only imagine what the 20,000 people smelled like after 3 days.
It just hit me. Did anyone take a 3DS?
I took a 3DS.
Did you street pass Bill? I did too. Or like, did you street pass anyone important?
Oh no, I didn't get any of those. Oh, my street pass is always full, and I never cleaned it out.
Oh, that's a shame.
When Bill came down, everyone who pulled their 3DS out, you could see the flashing green, and so people were totally getting street passed by Bill for sure. I unfortunately ran out of batteries, so I didn't get the real Bill.
Well, that's
luckily
a rookie
they
mistake,
sent him
huh?
out as a Yeah, I know, man, it's horrible. But I mean, at least they sent Bill out for promotional purposes in the past. Just
I didn't even get Bill. So I got Aonuma out of there. I got Aonuma and Miyamoto. I didn't even get Bill.
Yeah, I had those two as well. But I'm pretty sure Bill was a thing one time because I have him.
I think it was Iwata, both Reggies, Bill, Aonuma, and Miyamoto. I think those are the five. Maybe Sakurai too.
Well, thanks everyone for joining us for our 11th episode of Hello Nintendo. Please be sure to comment on the thread that this is going to be on the subreddit. Let us know what you thought and any suggestions you might have for future episodes. Again, thank you very much to Michael and James from the mod team for joining us and telling us about your E3 adventures. It was definitely a big eye-opener. It was really interesting to hear first-hand experiences from there and from people that are not part of the, you know, the media. Where we can get, a much more personal experience and recount. So be sure to check out our next episode of Hello Nintendo, where we'll be talking some more about some Switch games, and we'll be discussing the Breath of the Wild DLC Pack 1. Alright, talk to you guys later. Blah, 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 blah,